Hello everyone. In this video, I am going to explain the answers to the questions asked in the previous university exams from the topic vibrations. These are the list of questions I am going to discuss in this video. Find the time period of simple pendulum. A ball of mass is hanging from the ceiling with the help of the string of length L. First, draw the free body diagram. The weight is acting downward and tension is acting upward through the string. Now resolve this weight into along this tension and perpendicular to that. That means we get mg cos theta and mg sin theta. When this pendulum is moving right up, then there will be acceleration acting towards right up. The acceleration can be resolved two components. One is acting along string AN and perpendicular to the string AT. Now we are ready with free body diagram. To determine the time period of simple pendulum, now I can apply Newton's second law or energy method or relief method. Here I am going to apply Newton's second law. This method also known as equilibrium method or D'Alembert's method. Apply Newton's second law along the direction of AT, and the ball is moving right up. That means this is the minimum force acting along that directions, hence it is minus mg sin theta equal to mat. Now cancelling m on both sides, we get minus g sin theta on the left side and at we can get from this simple calculation, simplification of this. At is nothing but d square s by dt square. This can be written as s double dot. From this diagram we can get s equal to this length, arc length s equal to radius into theta. Here radius is nothing but l, so s equal to l theta. Differentiating two times we get s double dot equal to l double dot. So s double dot is nothing but your at. At equal to l theta double dot. Substituting this in this equation we get right hand side. Reducing this equation we get this equation, and again further reducing we can get this one. Here the sin theta can be replaced as theta when theta is small. So while doing this simple pendulum experiment, the theta must be very small. If it is more theta, then this assumption is invalid. So when theta is small, we can write sin theta as theta. Now compare this equation with equation of simple harmonic motion. By comparing, we can get omega n square equal to g upon l, hence omega n equal to root of g upon l. Now substituting this omega n value in this linear frequency equation, we get linear frequency equal to this much, and to get the time period, substitute this linear frequency here. So we get time period of the simple pendulum is 2 pi into root of L upon G. This is the answer for this question. Find the natural frequency of the system shown in figure. This system consists of a rolling disc and a spring, and the rolling disc is subjected to clockwise moment or torque, so that the disc will move towards right and the spring subjected to elongation. To solve this problem, I am going to use energy method, not Newton's method. The energy method says that the total energy of the any system is constant. In this system, the total energy is given by kinetic energy of this disk due to its translatory motion plus kinetic energy of this disk due to rotary motion and then plus the potential energy of the spring. Because the disk is having the general plane motions, it can have kinetic energy due to translatory as well as rotary motion. The kinetic energy due to translatory motion is given by half mv square. We can write x dot. And due to rotary motions, half I omega square. Omega is nothing but theta dot. We can write omega as theta dot. And potential energy of the spring, we know that is equal to half kx square. Now, when the disk is rotating at an angle of theta, then this arc length x can be written as x equal to r theta. Differentiating this equation, we can get x dot equal to r theta dot. And mass moment of inertia of the disk is given by half mr square. Substituting these two values in this equation, we get this equation. And reducing this equation, we get this equation. That means this is half mr square theta dot square. This is 1 by 4 mr square theta dot square. 1 by 2 plus 1 by 4 is nothing but 3 by 4. And then write this term as it is. This is the total kinetic, total energy of the system. As per the energy method, the total energy of the system is constant. Now differentiating this equation with respect to time. To get this equation, we have to use this concept. Differentiating theta square with respect to time, we get 2 theta and theta dot. And then differentiating theta dot square, we get 2 theta dot into theta double dot. This is nothing but the chain rule. Applying this concept while differentiating this equation with respect to time, we can get this equation. Now reducing this equation, that is cancelling this 2 and 4, we get 3 by 2 mr square theta double dot, and then plus kr square theta equal to 0. That means here theta dot is cancelled from the both the terms. So finally we get this equation. Now I am going to compare this equation with the equation, differential equation of spring mass system. Here comparing these two, I can get k equal to kr square and m equal to 3 by 2 mr square. Substituting these two values in this equation, we get natural frequency of the system is equal to root of 2k upon 3m radian per second. This is the answer for this question. Determine the natural frequency of the vibration of the spring mass system taking into account the mass of the spring. Important thing is considering the mass of the spring. Without mass of the spring, we get natural frequency of the spring mass system equal to omega n equal to root of k by m. Now we are going to derive the natural frequency of the spring mass system by considering the mass of the spring. Let rho is the mass of the spring per unit length. Per unit length, the mass of the spring is rho. Then L is the length of the total spring, total length of the spring. Hence total mass of the spring is given by rho into L. The total mass of the spring ms is equal to rho into L. In this problem, to determine the natural frequency, I am going to apply again the energy method. Consider a small element of spring of length delta y, del y, at a distance of y from the fixed end of the spring. Therefore, the velocity of this small element at this point is given by y upon l into x dot. Y is the distance from the fixed end for the small element, and l is the total length, that is total length of the spring from the free end to the mass, and x dot is the velocity of the mass for this total length. If you want to check this equation whether this is correct or not, substitute y value at this point. At this point y is 0. Substituting y is 0, we get velocity at this point is 0. It is valid because this point is fixed with the ceiling, hence velocity at the point is 0. Now suppose you want to find the velocity at this point. Substitute y by l, total length. So we will get l by l, it will be cancelled, we get x dot. That means it is satisfying both the boundary conditions at the two ends. It is a valid equation. This equation is obtained from by comparing this total velocity divided by total length equal to velocity of the small element v divided by the distance of the small element from the ceiling y. So from that, by reducing it, we get v equal to velocity of the small element is nothing but y by l into x dot. This velocity is obtained by this way. Now the kinetic energy of the spring. There are two element here, one is mass and the spring. Here we are considering the mass of the spring, hence the spring can have kinetic energy as well as potential energy. Potential energy of the spring is given by the formula of kx square. We no need to derive that one, but however we have to derive this kinetic energy of this spring. So now kinetic energy of this small element of the spring is given by half mv square, half into mass of the small element of spring into velocity of the small element of the spring whole square. Of mass of the small element of the spring is given by rho into del y, because rho is mass of the spring per unit length. If it is a small unit length, you multiply rho into del y for the total mass of the spring, rho into total length. So mass of the small element of spring is given by rho into del y, and the velocity of the small element of spring is given by this formula. Substitute here, you can get the kinetic energy of the small element of the spring. To get the total kinetic energy of the spring, integrate it from 0 to L, total length. Now by integrations we will get this equation. Here rho L is nothing but total mass of the spring. Substitute this ms in terms of, instead of rho L, here the kinetic energy of the spring is given by 1 by 2 into ms upon 3 into x dot square. So we can write kinetic energy of the spring is 1 by 2 ms upon 3 into x dot square. The kinetic energy of the mass is given by half mv square, that is half m x dot square. We can write v equal to x dot, and potential of the spring is given by half kx square. Hence the total kinetic energy of the system is the kinetic energy of the spring plus kinetic energy of the mass, and potential energy of the system is given by potential energy of the spring. So the total energy is nothing but sum of the kinetic energy plus potential energy. So according to this energy method, the total energy with respect to, derivative of total energy with respect to time is always 0. That means the total energy is constant differentiating that total energy with respect to time, which lead to zero. My now differentiate that all the energies and reduce that, you will get this equation. Now comparing this equation with simple harmonic motion, we can get omega n square equal to k upon m plus ms by 3. So from that we will get omega n equal to this value. This is the answer for this question. Differentiate between free and forced vibrations. First, we define what is vibration. Any motion which repeats itself after an interval of time is called vibration or oscillation or periodic motion. In other words, we can say it's a to and fro motions are called vibrations. All bodies possessing mass and elasticity are capable of producing vibrations. First, the free or natural vibration. Elastic vibrations in which there is no friction and external force after the initial release of the body are known as free or natural vibrations. That means once the system is released, then there won't be no force acting on that. It is continued to vibrate for up to infinite times. That means the amplitude of this vibration never decreases. It continue at infinite times. Damped vibrations. When the energy of the vibrating system is gradually dissipated by friction or other resistances, then that vibrations are called damped vibrations. These vibrations gradually reduces and finally come to rest. See here, the initial amplitude is more, and every cycle the amplitude of this vibration decreases and come to rest. If the damping is more, then it comes to early to rest. If it is damped less, that means the resistance is less, it will take more time to come to rest. The force vibrations. When a repeated force continuously act on a system, the vibrations are said to be forced. Now consider this vibrating system. These are free vibrating system. Once the force is applied and it causes the oscillation or vibrations, and the force is removed in the absence of any other resistance force, it will continue to vibrate. It will continue to vibrate. Then that vibration is known as free vibrations. The differential equation of this free vibration is given by this equation. And here in this system, a spring mass with a resistance to motion. The resistance to motion is known as damper. The C is known as damping coefficient. The damper can be a fluid or anything which can cause decrease its amplitude. The differential equation for damped vibrations is given by this equation. And this system having spring, damper, also the periodic force. The sign omega t indicate the force F naught is periodic nature. So this is when the force is applied periodically on the system, this is known as forced vibration. The differential equation or equation of motion for this force vibration is given by this equation. So when there is no periodic force, the right hand side becomes zero, then this equation reduces to damped equation of motion. When there is no damper, then this term becomes zero, this equation becomes reduces to equation of free vibration. Period. It is a time taken by a motion to repeat itself and cycle. It is a motion completed during one time period. It is a motion completed during one time period. And frequency is the number of cycle per second. Here its unit is hertz or cycles per second. This unit is for linear frequency. If it is a circular frequency, the unit is radian per second. Resonance. When the frequency of the system and the natural frequency of the system coincide, then that condition is known as resonance. And this resonance causes more vibrations, and this is more dangerous to the system. It must be avoided. The linear frequency fn is given by circular natural frequency upon 2 pi. The unit of natural frequency is hertz or cycles per second. The unit of natural circular frequency is given by this formula, and that unit is radian per second. The time period is given by the formula 1 upon linear frequency of the system. What are overdamped, critically damped and underdamped vibrations? Damping is nothing but resistance to the motion. When eta equal to 1, the damping is called critical. Eta greater than 1, it is known as overdamped. Eta less than 1, the system is underdamped. Then what is theta? The theta is nothing but it is the ratio of actual damping coefficient by critical damping coefficient. The theta also known as damping factor. So this damping factor is the ratio of actual damping coefficient upon critical damping coefficient. This value is equal to 1, then the damping is critical. Greater than 1, the system is overdamped. Less than 1, the system is underdamped. Now look at this image. First see this curve. The amplitude is not decreasing in each cycle. It is having the same amplitude in each cycle. That means this curve represents the free vibration or undamped vibrations. And when eta less than 1, that is known as underdamped, this situation is represented by this curve. That means on each cycle the amplitude decreases and finally it reaches to rest. It comes to rest. When the system is underdamped, it executes a vibratory motion, but finally it comes to rest. Now come to consider the other two situations. When eta equal to 1, see, it is never crossing this timeline. That means it never undergoes any vibrations. Similarly, when the system is overdamped, that is when eta is greater than 1, again this dotted line never cross this timeline. That means the system never undergoes the vibratory motion. So undamped system, that means free vibrations, vibrates at its frequency. So there is no decrease in its amplitude. It continues to vibrate for long time. When the system is underdamped, the amplitude of this system is decrease, and after some time it comes to rest. The ratio of successive amplitude being constant. In the critical damping, where eta equal to 1, the system does not vibrate and the mass m moves back slowly to the equilibrium position, not very fast. If you think the automatic door, if it closes very fast, it may hit the person who opened the door. So it will reach to rest by slowly, but not taking much time. Overdamped system does not vibrate and come to rest after much more time. Thank you.